What's up, everybody? It's yours truly, Mr. John Paul Lange. I've never mentioned my middle name on the channel, but funny story, came across a YouTube video this morning, actually, about the mysterious disappearance of a man named John Paul Lange. Super, super weird. I literally, hey, you can keep watching that if you want. Okay. Well, chilling here with my wifey, Chloe. We have no kids at the house, which is literally never happens. We have 4 children, 4 years and under. We have an almost 1-year-old, a 2-year-old, a 3-year-old, and a 4-year-old. Hey, Gigi. My mom commented. First of a comment. What's up, D-Buck? No, honestly, we're sitting here watching this show on, what's it on?
HBO.
It's super cool. I literally just stood up and I was like, you know what? I need to make a YouTube video. I've been talking to my wife here about wanting to get more active on the YouTube channel. In previous days. And I just was like, you know what? I need to just update everybody. So this I want to just go live and kind of talk about a pivot move we made. What's up, Fogarty? Remember meeting you over at the convention. Looks like you're still doing good. Making some pivot moves yourself. So good for you. Where was I? Oh, I got some good footage. I just haven't got around to editing it and, you know, throwing it together to make a video. But so we made a pivot move for the winter. And it's junk removal. So I don't know if anyone's been interested in junk removal, but it made sense for us. I want to tell you a little backstory on it. As you guys know, I'll talk about Xmas lights in a second here. Or Christmas lights. But we had a trailer, right? We had the 16-foot trailer. We had everything on our rig, and I ended up tearing it down and cramming everything into the van and the pickup truck that we had. And it just worked better, easier employee-wise, not having to worry about training guys to drive a trailer if they didn't know how. Arkansas Soft Wash. Buy your skids at arkansassoftwash.com. No, seriously, Sean. Gratitude, man. I appreciate that, really. Man, that came at a good time, too. I got a water bill I got to get paid. I went down there to get it paid today, and then I was like, oh, shit. It's what, Saturday? But anyway, thanks, Sean. I appreciate that. He sent another. He sent another. Sean, thank you. Thank you, man. All right, let me get to the point. So I had the trailer. We had the rigs on it and everything. It was just too big. It was just too much. We didn't need it. We're heavy residential. We do the commercial, but still. Anyway, so we had this empty trailer, brand new trailer that I had purchased, just sitting there all 2020. Just sitting there, and some of 2019. I'm like, man, it's just such a waste. I thought about selling it, but I'm like, what am I going to sell it for? A couple grand, you know? Like, it's just not worth it. Like, we could make way more than a couple grand with it. Like, what's the point of selling it? So I'm like, let's just start a junk removal thing. I made a Google My Business real quick on it. Just did the DBA real quick. So Wally's Professional Services is an LLC. So we just do the DBA under Wally's and just see what happens. Nothing was happening, but I wasn't pushing it really either. It was just kind of something I wanted to at least get the ball rolling on. So my soon-to-be wife here, Chloe, she's super thrifty. She makes a lot of money just buying and selling stuff on Facebook Marketplace or whatever, you know, just flipping stuff for profit, she came across this desk. We were looking for a desk in my room to fit in this corner, this odd corner. And this desk was like weirdly shaped, but it was perfect for this corner that we wanted a desk in. And they were selling it for $5. And I was like, oh shit, let's go get that right now. We raced down there. It turned out to be this museum that was going out of business. And it was just torn up. And, you know, just being personable and talking and, you know, what are you guys doing with all this? And blah, blah, blah. They were just giving stuff away. It was crazy. But I ended up spending $105 there, but walking out with a ton of stuff. $1,000 worth of shit easily. But just making conversation, I found out they were hiring a junk removal service to get rid of all this stuff. And she even told me what they quoted it for, which was $7,000. So I walked around and I'm like, I told her, hey, you know, I have a junk removal business. We just started it. Let me back up real quick. They also knew me because they happened to be a client of ours for window cleaning services. And anyway, it's a long story. Basically, the museum was owned by a commercial client we have. And yada, yada, yada. Anyway, so there was a little bit of, what's the word I'm looking for?
History?
A relationship. Yeah. History, whatever. Yeah. There's a little bit of relationship there, but not with the person I was talking with. Anyway, they said they were quoted $7,000, and I took a walk around there and I said, listen, we can take care of you for $5,000 right now, and we can start in 2 days. And pretty much as soon as they said that, they said, let's go. So first junk removal job we ever did, $5,000. I ended up spending almost $1,200 in dump fees. Anyway, I have all the footage on this. I'm gonna go way more in depth with it. Kind of like make it into like a what to expect with, or, you know, just like a troubleshooting thing. Like, hey, like, what's the real deal with junk removal? What's some helpful tips? Because we learned a lot, for one, but two, we made a lot of money right before Christmas. I guaranteed them we'd get it done in 5 days or less. And yeah, so we had it done by Christmas. Got, you know, $5,000 on the 23rd, right before Christmas. It was really nice. And we did the 20% deposit, or 25% deposit is the new rule. Everything is 25% deposit, $225 minimum. And that's with washing and everything. But anyway, I think it's gonna work out really well. There's a lot of money in garbage, junk removal, you know. Everyone has junk, everyone has garbage. Just like everyone needs things cleaned or power washed or whatever you're doing, there is money in it. And really, what's cool about it, what's really enticing to me, is you don't need much. You know, obviously a dump trailer or a dump truck is ideal, but starting off, all you would need is a trailer. I even got footage on how we built the walls up. We put together walls using like a 4x8 plywood and 2x4s. And we basically turned that 16-foot trailer into a rolling 15-yard dumpster. And I have all the footage to throw together on how we built that. And we built it in 6 hours. I ended up having to stay up till 3 a.m. putting this together the day before the job, actually. That's why I said we can get started in 2 days, because I knew we didn't even have the walls on the trailer. But made it happen. And I'm excited about the junk removal thing. I'm turning it into an LLC. You know, and that's a whole other topic. You know, if you guys aren't LLC already, you should. It's a couple $100. And with all these COVID relief packages coming out, it's really beneficial to have an LLC, because you should be able to get you know, $5,000 at least in relief, even if you're a very, very, very small owner operator. I just had Panda Express. I'm getting like heartburn over here. I had the shrimp and the shrimp walnut and steak chow mein. All right, let me read some comments here. You said I'm going back to sleep. Sean, thanks much, man. I'll talk to you tomorrow. Mr. Sean and I, we've been talking, man. Hopefully we can get some of the stuff we've been talking about, get the ball rolling on it, because we got some cool build ideas coming out soon, hopefully. Spoke with a guy in Georgia about this. Definitely said get a 3500, transmission turns to crap quick. I'd be happy with a 2500. A guy could start a trash junk removal service using dump trailers. Yeah. There you go, Logan. Yeah, I mean, it works for us because we, like I said, we had the 16-foot trailer already empty, not doing anything. So, and it's something you can do in the winter. Okay, yeah, let's talk about Christmas lights. So, Christmas lights was a shit show for us. Just gonna be blunt. There's a lot of money in Christmas lights. It was a bad year, unfortunately. There's a lot of money in Christmas lights. However, there was a lot I didn't know about it. The busiest time of the year, it seems like at least, would be late November, you know, right before December hits. We had done 2 installs early to mid-November. And then towards the end of, you know, halfway through November, a little bit later, we got bombarded with requests. We did at least 10 different estimates. One of them could have been a huge, it makes me cringe to think about it. It could have been a huge, epic freaking job. They wanted like twinkly lights and they wanted shit all over their like silo. Like, you know, we live in kind of a country area. Rural area. The town is established, but on the outskirts of it is all cornfields and bean fields. But, I honestly, and this is being on the low end, we missed out on at least $25,000 in Christmas lights. And the reason being, we were getting requests for estimates late November. We did the estimates. And as I'm doing the estimates, I'm calling the vendors that I know, which was quite a few. I even had people recommending vendors. And now all of a sudden they're out of stock, back order, out of stock, back, like they ran out of everything. I mean, fucking everything. We didn't have really any inventory. The only inventory we had was pretty much already accounted for with the jobs we already had secured. So we were stuck telling these people who were accepting estimates, the lead time is 2 to 3 weeks because shipping was taking forever on things. We're having to hunt stuff down. And by then we're what? One to 2 weeks before Christmas, nobody wanted to pull the trigger on it at that point. They're like, well, what's the point? You know, we want to enjoy the lights. We don't want to put them up just for Christmas Day. So that was a hard pill to swallow, but really the where I went wrong was not researching it enough and realizing we needed to be stocked up way heavier with inventory and procrastinating. We probably should have been marketed sooner and purchased stuff sooner. And, you know, so next year, 2021, I already know it'll be a awesome, 'cause there's a market for us. There's a need, there's a market, there's a demand. It was proven just off, literally the only marketing we did was 2 magazine ads, which are spaced apart, 2 months apart. We had done one August or September, and then we did one again in November. When the November one hit, that's when it was over with. But that's when we had a lot of calls. So yeah, long story short, if you wanna do Christmas lights, just get your money up, and I would say, invest at least $2,500 into some lights and stuff. Everyone talks about C9 bulbs. We use C9 the whole time. you know, 1,000-foot spool, C9. I like them, I guess. I feel like, honestly, though, the C7 bulbs have a little more options, colors, and you can just do more with them. And I had this residential client who didn't really care for the color of the warm white. She wished they were warmer. Just a side note, if you're watching and you're thinking about Christmas lights, it's hard to not make money on it, but it's easy to lose money if you don't have your inventory in a row. So, for example, we have this residential client who was quoted $1,500. She was our very first client who accepted a Christmas light estimate, right? So that's already, you know, a problem. The house, at first glance, seemed like it was going to be easy in and out. It should have been a $2,500 job. I quoted it $1,500. And because of the headache and the catastrophe with, I mean, there was at one point we were waiting. We waited almost 2 weeks for a bow, a red bow. And sorry, Sean made me faint. Sean, I know I'm playing around and shit, but dude, thank you so much. For real, that means a lot. Dude, hey, winter is tough on everybody. Like, you know, even if you're in Florida, I imagine it's got to slow down, right? Like, it's winter. It's Sean. But it's winter. It's got to be tough times for everybody, right? So I don't know, man. The only way to make it in business is what I'm realizing is just the ability to just always be pivoting. Like, and it's sometimes I feel like I'm going insane personally, like, because I'll be having these crazy plans and I'll start executing on them and I'm like, this is bulletproof. This shit's bulletproof. We're gonna fucking crush it once we pull the trigger on this, and then we get fucking derailed with some crazy shit, whatever is going on, whether it's an employee quitting or some pandemic or whatever, and then we gotta change the plan. And it's like, dude, am I losing my shit or what's the dealio? But I know it's worth talking about, man. Winter's stressful, winter's hard. So Sean, again, thank you very much, because, you know, it might look like we're doing a lot, like I'm busy and crushing it or doing a lot, but I'm really not, man. I'm struggling and trying to make ends meet just like everybody else. Sean over here is Mr. Moneybags. Sean can't keep up with the demand. His builds are, he's always like, overextending himself. He'll have some badass little builds, he'll piss off some competition, and then he'll like sell a bunch of the kits or whatever. I don't know, it's just funny. Sean knows what he's doing. Oh shit. Damn, Ben. Thank you, bro. Man, holy shit. You guys are tripping me out. I should have went live a long time ago. Thank you for the love. I'm going to read this right now. Hold on. I'm glad the junk move worked to get you out of the punch. Super awesome, man. We use open trading as our go-to off-time rep. Pretty awesome stuff. Made more than extra stuff. Definitely going to continue. Yeah, I'm going to call you pretty soon here, actually, Ben. What do you mean by open trading? I used to be really into Bitcoin, and I've been following it again lately, and I've been investing a little bit. Can you guys believe that shit? Over 30,000. I remember when I invested in Bitcoin, it was $4,000 or $5,000 a coin or whatever, and I sold it at 13,000. It jumped up to 20, And I held on, and then I was watching the charts as they fell all the way down to 13. You know, I knew I should have sold before that, but I kept holding, hoping for a miracle. But once I got to 13, I was like, all right, I got to get out this jam. But still, 4,000 or 5,000 to 13, I doubled my money in the end of it. In between that, I was trading, but I can't believe it's at 30-something thousand. I thought it would have dropped by now. Crypto is like the stock market on steroids. I mean, it's like, you just, if you invest money in crypto, you basically have to write that money off right away, mentally. Like, just accept the fact that it's gone, so you're not like emotionally attached when you miss out, you know? Because it's so volatile. There's no, people try to read charts, but you never know what the fuck it's doing. It's gonna crash here soon though, mark my words. You have 4 whole Bitcoins? I wish I invested the first time I heard about Bitcoin, man. I don't think that shit was even over $100 when I first very, very heard about it. But I was in high school and didn't give a shit. Just thought it was interesting. Option trading. I don't know. I still don't know what you're talking about. I'm into crypto big time. You can make a lot. But you gotta like... you gotta... I don't know, not get too into it, not get too confident, I guess, because you can lose it all real quick. Oh, Tesla, shit, man, I wish I got into Tesla. Good for you. The fuse is going to detail, shit. That's the thing people don't get. All right, I'm gonna say this one last thing about crypto, and then I'm done, because I'll go down a rabbit hole. But mathematically, because real quick, there's only a certain amount of Bitcoin, right? There'll only be, I think it's 21 million coins or some shit, I don't know. But there's only ever going to be a certain amount of Bitcoin. Whereas like the American dollar, we just keep printing the shit, right? There's only a certain amount of Bitcoin. So when it's all bought up, it's all bought up, it's over with. So if you do the math, if 10% of the world adopts Bitcoin. Adopt meaning 10% of the world is using Bitcoin. They're trading it day in, day out. They're using it as currency, they're whatever. Just 10% of the world. If 10% of the world adopts Bitcoin, each Bitcoin would be worth $1 million. That's how insane it is. I know it's hard to wrap your brain around because it's an intangible coin. It's something you can't touch or see or feel. It's just some digital bullshit. But in a fucked up way, that shit holds more value than the American dollar. Just because it is what it is. You know, it's the blockchain and all that shit is hard to wrap your mind around, but whatever. I can go down a wormhole on that shit, but it's really, anyone who's watching, if you're not into it, it's worth, at the very least, throwing $100 at it. Throw $100 in it, and see what happens when you're retired, you know? What do you got to lose? $100? I mean, think about all the doubtful people who invested in Bitcoin in 2010 when it was like a penny or 30 cents or whatever, and it's $33,000 right now. That was just 2010, 10 years ago. Like, what the fuck, man? Oh. Bitcoin's always gonna be the grandfather of it all. Gonna be the, you know, a lot of these other coins are building their structure off of Bitcoins. I'm into HEX though. I'm a Richard Hart fan. HEX is only going up, baby. Anyway, all right, I'm done. I said I was done. Cause, yeah. So what's everybody up to? What's your New Year plans? New Year resolution? New Year plans? What's the biggest pivot you guys have had to do? Drop a comment on the biggest pivot you had to make. And I want to hear it. What had to change drastically to stay in business and stay profitable and stay sane? $1 million a coin. $400 a coin? I think it's a million, but it all depends on how adapted it gets. All right. I'll tell you all about it. Calls and puns, man. God damn, Ben. 6 digits, serious, huh? Turn your minivan into a pressure washing rig. Hey, man, I've seen that done before. It can do it. It can do it. All you need is a fucking hose reel, right? Get your power washer and a goddamn hose reel. The whales are major holders. No, it's, I don't know who you're listening to, MTH Power Wash, but Bitcoin's been doing this up and down, double peak bullshit all its life. It's not going anywhere, but you're absolutely right. You got your whales and you got your ETFs, you got your stockholder, you got your trust funds. I mean, you got so many, and when this money runs out, when they're done throwing money at this, it is going to drop. I mean, there's no doubt it's going to fucking plummet. What goes up must come down, but you have to look at the all-time charts. I mean, it's always the new low, the new bottom is always higher than what it was previously, and the new high is always higher than what it was. It's a pattern. It's a consistent pattern. Dogecoin, what Elon Musk was pumping as a joke. You always need to be holding Dogecoin because these celebrities and big names, they think it's funny to pump it. I remember making, shit, dude. It was like close to 500% gains on Dogecoin just because it's a funny ass coin with a dog picture. It's D-O-D-G-E. I can't remember, but it's a useless coin, right? And so, like, jokingly, celebrities would be like, it's all about Dogecoin. As soon as they tweet that shit, poof, skyrockets at least 100%. And it happens throughout the year. It's crazy. It depends on whoever's tweeting about it. But it's fun to hold on to that shit, because why not? Just keep positive, John. Spring is coming. Yeah, you got it, Sean. Shit, I'll feed my family for the next 3 months off this $99.99 3X. Really appreciate it, man. Okay, I'm starting to lose my spot. I gotta keep reading. Yeah, money, 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 baby. Yeah. So some mistakes I made would have been purchasing that shop. I should have never done that. We'll make it happen, you know, we'll figure it out, but that shop was stupid. And the reason is, between the rent I pay for our condo and the rent I pay for the shop, we're paying $3,000 a month in rent. And I don't know why I did this, because we could have easily got a mortgage on like a nice little farmette with like a 4 or 5 car garage, shop, something I could own. And it'd be under $3,000 a month. So that was kind of dumb. But whatever at the same time. So basically all that means is we got a real shop. We got a commercial location. Pump it. Oh, I wanted to mention this. Oh, let me end that. We're going to pump it up, systemize it, make it flowing, automate it, make it profitable. You know, we'll figure it out, and then we'll go buy our house that we wanted, and then business and personal life will be separate. But at this commercial spot we got. This is pretty cool. We're actually U-Haul dealers now. So we're waiting on some stuff to get delivered, but we actually are gonna have like U-Haul trucks and stuff at our location, which is super nice. We have a gas station. Literally, to turn into our shop, you have to drive, you turn in right off this highway, or not highway, but main road. This road is called Peace Road, and it can get you to the interstate to get to Chicago. It can get you to Naperville. I mean, it can get you to all the big locations. So it's perfect. It's the perfect, most well-known road ever in our area. And to turn into our shop, you turn in, and there's three different buildings. One building is like a strip mall. The other one is a gas station. And then the other one is us. So if we have U-Haul trucks here, we got the gas station. Like, you have to drive past the gas station to get to us. So that's pretty epic. The U-Haul trucks are going to be awesome if we have a big junk removal job and we got to use one of the trucks. U-Haul is amazing. It's a $0. You don't pay anything up front to get into the franchise. You just have to have a shop, commercial location, $0 up front. They bring the trucks there, drop them off, and you just rent them out. Yeah, I mean, you can make money being a U-Haul dealer, right? There's a guy, a town over, about 30 minutes over in Rockford. He does $400,000 to $450,000 a year just in U-Hauls, and they're a car mechanic shop. He gets 20% commission off of the sales on average. It's 20 to 22% on average, because each thing, you know, has a different bracket. So he made 22%, 20 to 22% off of 400,000 just this year. So what's that? Just under 100,000? So the way U-Haul struck, and they don't, you know, the way U-Haul will present their business to you is a plug-in to your existing business. So we have U-Haul now, but think of how this ties into window cleaning, power washing, and junk removal. See, it's all like a cycle. Like, so picture this scenario. We got Mr. and Mrs. Jones moving in from Texas or something. Just got a new house, and the sellers didn't clean their windows or power wash. They need a facelift, you know? And we just get to talking because they rented their U-Haul truck from us. Or maybe someone's moving out and they realize, we don't want to take all this. This is a bunch of junk. So they move out using one of our U-Haul trucks, and we take care of all their junk, you know? It's like a plug-in to our business. So it's gonna build and develop more relationships to our existing business, and the U-Haul thing is just like a complimentary service. So if you have a shop, I mean, it's worth looking into, I would say. Keep in mind, we haven't rented a single truck yet. We don't even have trucks on the lot. Like, I literally, you know, signed the agreement and contract and yada 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 just a few days ago. But within a couple weeks, we'll be renting out U-Haul trucks and stuff. Kind of a clever way to even get into junk removal, though, you know? You could essentially rent a box truck and throw all the junk in there. So, yeah, so for U-Haul, they only require that someone's actually there like 3 hours out of the day. And you can make your own, you make your own hours for U-Haul. So you could essentially become a U-Haul dealer and say, we're only open one day a week, you know? It's one of those things, but U-Haul is getting with the times. So they have it, they've been doing more of, they got things set up where basically we would leave the keys in a disclosed location, and the person would rent you, like a contactless, I never meet the person, everything's done online through their program, stuff like that. But like our shop is very industrial, so everything's just done on an iPad. You rent out a vehicle within 5 minutes, and half the time you don't even have to meet the people. No more choosing between food and lights. Yeah, well, premium detail pros, I get what you're saying, but at the same time, you could go get yourself a 4-gallon-a-minute power washer, a hose reel, and a truck, a little Ford Ranger. No buffer tank needed. Get you some, you know, make sure you buy a few cases of bleach whenever you have a job. You can get yourself a little helper, side time, you know, maybe a part-time guy. And work it out with them. Say, hey man, I got this house wash scheduled for $400. What if I gave you $150 or $100 or whatever it is? $100. Would you go do it for me? Sure. All right, cool. The keys are in the glove box. Go pick up the Ranger. And yeah, with a 4-gallon-a-minute, you just gotta hook the garden hose up to the power washer and no buffer tank. Drop that downstream injector in a little 5-gallon bucket full of bleach and wash away. I overcomplicated things when I first started. And it's funny because I've made investments in overly complicated or excessive stuff. You know, the shiny new tool. And at one point during 2020, I would remove the cool thing and just make it more basic, just straightforward to the point, you know? Why, like, for example, no offense to anybody, but the remote downstream injector turn off, turn on thing is the stupidest thing in the world to me. Because if you wash the house the right way, you can turn the injector on and off when you happen to be in the front yard or walking past the vehicle. Anyway, what's the point of having this clicker and praying to God that it reached the sensor and the soap is either on or off? Because to really know if the soap is on or off, you have to stand there and pull that trigger and spray for, 30 to 60 seconds. And then wait and see if there's any soap in the line. So what happens when you wait a whole minute and you realize, oh shit, man, the soap's not turning off. Then you're going back to the vehicle anyway. I mean, just like stuff like that. It's like, why overcomplicate it? You know, like just go take your lazy ass to the truck and pull the siphon or turn the switch. You know, whatever. Maybe you have a bypass. And it's an electrical on and off thing. It's a little key fob you could lose or break. I mean, there's so many things that could go wrong with that. Why do it? Same with electric hose reels. I've never used one. I'm sure it's an awesome thing. You know, rolling up the hose sometimes sucks. But if you take an extra couple minutes and lay that hose out straight and lay it out the right way with no kinks or twirls or whatever, and then you go back to the van and reel it up by hand, it's okay. You know, I came from doing tree work, you know, like we lift up 200-pound logs all day. You know, maybe some of these guys are coming from desk jobs or corporate jobs, and it's like heavy labor to them or something, but washing a house ain't shit. So sometimes that just overcomplicates it. So just lean, mean, scalable, clonable, you know, like I would like to have a fleet of vehicles all set up the same way, which is a simple formula. I'm sure those hose reels are nice, but what happens when they malfunction or it breaks or whatever? There's not even a handle. There's not even an emergency handle on them. What do you do then? I would like an. I'd actually like an answer on that. I'm curious. I'm like, that's my biggest thing when I was looking at those. I was like, what if it breaks? Like everything, like every mechanical thing in the world will break. What happens when your hose reel breaks? You can't even emergency use a hand reel to reel it up. Yeah, you don't need the fancy, you know, there's certain things here and there that are nice, or maybe you really want and you want to use it. And it's, but some of the stuff is ridiculous, in my opinion. I would love to, like, set up, you know, set something up one day. I talked briefly, or I mentioned at one point, like, doing a convention. And, like, you know, with a small group of guys, like 25 people or something. And then everybody can come back to the shop. We can have some drinks or something. Or just shoot the shit. Shop talk. And, like, play around with equipment. It would just be... It'd just be cool to see how everybody, like, really operates, you know, like, in the field. Because we're pretty quick with stuff. We don't mess around. Yeah, I used to do tree removal. Mario, I used to be the forgot a minute ex-jet bleach pail guy, but that to me is overcomplicating it. But I admire that you're doing it because you're making it happen, right? So I found out about soft washing and I was like, I'm just gonna do the downstream thing, and I bought my first downstream injector and it did not work. And I was frustrated, I made an embarrassment of myself on my first job, and I left. I told the guy I'd be back in a few days, something's broken. They came back. I tried something else, it didn't work, had to leave, came back. Luckily this guy was cool. Third time, I came back with the X-Jet. I was out of options, couldn't get the downstreaming to work, and made it happen, but I did blow out an outlet with like smoke pouring out of it. It freaked me out. My first soft washing job. And I continued to use the X-Jet, and after spilling that fucking, I had the bucket on a dolly, and after spilling that whole bucket of straight bleach in their yard a couple of times, I said, there's no more of this. I gotta figure out the downstreaming thing. And I would never wash a house with an X-Jet ever again. But what's cool is you're probably making money and profitable using an X-Jet and a bleach pail. And that's awesome, because at one point I was too. But when you get that downstream injector, you don't have to lug around a freaking pail of bleach anymore. You're going to be over twice as much profitable as you were with your X-Jet. X-Jet pail. Come on, man. Missing the point. Moonlight is a wrestler. Yeah, man. Ben, honestly, we should just have a get together. I mean, we should get like a group chat going of like the guys who are, you know, just the familiar names who are washing and cool. And just you guys should just come down and check things out, hang out for a day or two. Why not? You know, it doesn't have to be. I don't ever see myself being the guy who, like, structures a whole on event course thing, you know? It's just not my rodeo. It's probably my own, you know, I would feel funny teaching people how to do things. I'm pretty confident that there's certain things that we do that are pretty like probably the best way they could be done, as far as I know. But I don't know, I just feel funny about like trying to teach people or make it a course, but it would just be fun to hang out and come down and just talk shop, hear each other's ideas and whatever. I'll show you mine if you show me yours type thing. If you had to give up pressure washing or window cleaning, what would you give up? Pressure washing or window cleaning? That's a tough question. I would probably give up window cleaning. However, from like a business standpoint, I have a feeling window cleaning would probably be the better option to keep, because it's something you could essentially, you can do in lower degree weather. It's something that is needed more on a maintenance schedule. You know, businesses need that stuff clean. Where power washing, I mean, unless you're doing parking garages and stuff, I don't think people look at it as a maintenance thing. I think they look at it as whenever they think it's dirty, call you up and get it washed. I could be wrong, but I love power washing. I do. It's just, that's why I'm saying, from a business standpoint, I feel like the window cleaning might be more of a scalable, solid business. Especially from like a selling point. If you were to sell it and you had like 200 repeat clients who get their windows cleaned every 6 months, that's gonna make a better selling point than 500 power washing clients that you had in the past year who probably won't call you back next year, most likely, because you already cleaned their stuff and it won't get dirty for another 2 or 3 years. That's $200 for a house wash, 3,500 square feet or less. Good? I don't think it is. I know some crazy bastards who are washing houses for like $65, but where we're at in Illinois, where winter is at, where winter will, if we're lucky, last 3 months, but most likely four and a half months, where I'm at, we have a minimum of 225 now, and typically, like a 3,500 square foot house, we're not touching for less than 425. We really don't wash a house for 225 or really anything under 400 anymore. The 225 is more like if you want a driveway cleaned real quick, or like 225 is our minimum, like some basic, maybe like a basic gutter cleaning. But it used to not be that. Our minimum used to be $99, and it killed us, or not killed us, but it was stupid going to $99 jobs. But the 225 I can get behind, because I don't know, we can just, that's where we can make money. That's where it makes sense. Call up Bobby for what? Or Jason? What are they gonna help me with? Yeah, so like for house washing, the formula we used to do was like 16 cents a square foot. And then once you got over 3,500 square foot, that equation changed. So I forget what it was, but like over 3,500 square feet, it was like 15 or 14 cents a square foot. And then like every 1,000 square feet over that, it would drop like a penny per square foot. We had this equation that actually worked well, but it was also a little excessive. Basically, the things I look at when I'm quoting a house wash is the type of siding, how dirty it is, how the level of infestation. We have levels like 1 to 5. We'll put a level on it. 5 being extreme, lichen, green on all 4 sides. And then 1 being like, it's just dirty. Maybe there's green, maybe there's not. But it just needs to freshen up. But we have levels, and that adds a percentage to the price. And then we have the landscaping factor. Is there colorful flowers or unique plants or Japanese maple trees or whatever? Is there a ton of it? Is it a windy hose? You know, we got to worry about hoses ripping plants out. What did I say? The siding, level of infestation, landscaping, and then height. How tall is it? How many angles? Are there little, like, stupid one window cutouts coming from the roof and we have to wash all three sides of it? You know, all those things just come into factor, but it comes into factor, but it still typically is in a bracket of 425 starting, and then we move up to 750, and then we move up to 1500. Or I should say 1000 to 1500. So basically what we did is we just cut it up by day. So if we look at a place or look at a house and it's a bigger, tougher house, and we're like, this is gonna take at least half a day. If we get here at 8 o'clock, we're not leaving till 12 probably, then it's gonna be 750 or more. If it's gonna be a whole day project, it's gonna be at least 1500. You know, we're always wanting 2500 a day, but that for one vehicle, but that really rarely happens. I know a lot of guys do it, but we're just not there yet. We haven't figured out that delivery yet. But yeah, that's the best way we could do it, really, is we look at a project and we're like, is this going to take a couple hours, half a day, three quarters of the day, or a full day? That's really the best way to do it, because you're going to lose your mind. Oh, and don't ever tell people an exact time that you'll be there. You know, just tell them, due to the services you're receiving, weather plays a huge factor. We run into issues often where we might get delayed on a job. We are an exterior service, so the good news is you don't have to be home. We require a credit card on file. You don't have to be home for this service, so please do not take off work, because it's very common that we need to reschedule due to weather or unpredicted circumstances. But honestly, this might sound crazy, but for 2021, I'm thinking about giving people a range in days. Like, I'm talking, we should be able to get this done somewhere between Monday and Wednesday. You know, because like, for 2020, we did morning or afternoon. That was the tightest we would get. We say, yeah, we'll be there in the morning, or we'll be there in the afternoon. We would never give people 8 o'clock, 9 o'clock, 11 o'clock. You know, we would never give them an exact time, because that you'll lose your mind. And even with just morning or afternoon, I was struggling. We were struggling with that, because you know what happens when you show up to the shop and I can't even think of a circumstance, but I'm getting off in 7 minutes. I'm watching the clock.
Water's frozen.
Yeah, that happened just, yeah, our junk removal job was a nightmare. Honestly, now that I think about it, I mean, we got it done in 4 days. And then the fifth day was just, we did some sweeping and just making sure we got everything, met with the director and stuff. But we got it done in 4 days, just me and another guy. And I wasn't even there for what? Oh, yeah. Chloe came out. Chloe was beast mode. Did I get any footage of you tearing shit up? No? Damn. It's funny because it was me and Jason. Jason's awesome. He's very dependable. He was, you know, you can count on him. However, he just wasn't, he wasn't getting it all the way. He didn't know what to do, and I'm like, dude, there's a bunch of junk in here, just get it out of the freaking building. That's all you gotta do. But anyway, Chloe went in there and she was demoing the shit out of stuff. I'm like, whoa, Chloe, we're not demoing that. And she just kept demoing it anyway. I'm just kidding. She was tearing shit up though. But no, man, I went way off trail there. Oh, there was this gutter cleaning, this stupid gutter cleaning job. It was $450, and that's because there was some gutter sticks
involved five gutter sticks, so it brought the price up $125. Anyway, they had scheduled on a Monday, which was the same day as the junk removal. I thought we would have another helper, but he didn't end up coming in and told me that he's working somewhere else now, last minute. So I ended up having to leave Jason there all alone and go do the gutter cleaning. And I got there. I was a little late, so she was already irritated with me. I broke my own rule. I told her I would be there at 1. And 1:20 is when I showed up. Anyway, got there, set up. And I'm like, I'm checking things out. Anyway, long story short, the whole line was frozen. Like the whole tube from the tank to the power washer was a solid hose of ice. The filter was ice, everything was ice. Cause I left the van out. It was even my fault, which I hated. I wish I could have blamed it on someone else, but it was my fault. I left the van out over the weekend. Because our water pump broke on the truck and it was overheating and we had to use the van to pull the trailer. And anyway, so I told her, hey, Tuesday, I will be back. We're gonna get this taken care of. Sorry, the lines are frozen, my hands are tied. Came back Tuesday, the lines still weren't thawed out, it was still ice. I don't know what happened there, but Wednesday came along and everything was good and I got it done. But still, all three of those days, I left the junk removal job and came back. You know, even if it was 2 hours that I was gone, that still set us back. So, price per square feet is not the best. Price by the day. Just try to look, you know, it's just, you price by experience, by knowing how long it takes you to do things, kind of knowing your KPIs, your key performance indicators. How long does it take you to do this task? Try to figure that stuff out. How long does it take me to squeegee this window? To squeegee a double hung window? Like literally time it. And that's how you figure stuff out. And then when you look at a house with 200 windows and you know it takes you a minute to clean one window, you know that just the cleaning is gonna take 200 minutes, which is like half a day essentially. I mean, probably more, you know, it's more than half a day because you got drive time and setup time and well, you can't look at stuff as wanting to land the job. I know you want to land the job, but all you need to do is figure out what is this job worth to you. Like, how do I word this? I know you want to get the job. I'm in that situation all the time where I, like this junk removal job, I wanted it. But you have to be realistic too. Like, I would not do this junk removal job. If they would have came back at me and said, all right, we'll use you, but we don't want to pay over $4,000. I would have said, I'm sorry, I can't. Because at that point, I would have spent $1,200 in dump fees for all the freaking weight and garbage they had. I would have had to pay out in labor, which would have been almost $1,000. You know, it wouldn't have been worth it. So you kind of just got to know what it costs to do things and is it worth it or not. I'm getting off here in literally 50 seconds, guys. So any last words? This was fun. Yeah, I'm sure they slowed down, man. Mr. William. I don't know what services you can do. Message me on Facebook. Hopefully you're on Facebook, William. We'll have a little conversation about it. Cause there's not enough to know with your question. I know things have slowed down. Things slowed down for me too. But it's also below 30 degrees. It's probably 10 degrees. And it's been snowing and freezing rain. Everything's ice or snow. If I went and advertised power washing and window cleaning, it wouldn't make much sense, right? Because I can't even do it. So there's just not enough information there. That's why I said message me and we'll talk about it. gravity fed poles for window cleaning. No, I use a water fed pole. But yeah, guys. Hey, thank you. Thanks, sir. Thanks, everyone. Ben and Sean. You guys, man. For real. Much love. It's been fun. Hope you guys had a good Christmas and New Year. And man, 2021. Make it happen. Dude, no matter what they throw at us, you're not gonna fail. You're not gonna go to business. None of that bullshit. You just gotta pivot and make another plan. And if you feel crazy, just know Mr. Lang feels crazy right alongside of you. Cause I swear, I keep trying to make plans to pull myself through things and we just get hit with another hurdle, but find a way over it. Much love, guys. Take care.